Am I audible and is my slide visible?
Yes, ma'am, perfectly fine.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Rajiv, for inviting me and allowing me to talk about a very sensitive issue, that is the domestic violence. Now, whenever we talk about domestic violence, usually the advocates and judges are involved, and police officers who are doing the investigation. So these three people are the key aspect of investigating and giving justice to domestic violence victims. But as a forensic psychologist, I feel that we have a major role to play, not only in providing justice to domestic violence victims, but also to provide further rehabilitation and related aspects in case of domestic violence victims. Now, what is happening in domestic violence is that a case is being filed and it is being, it will undergo trials, number of trials, where the domestic violence victim will be asked numerous questions about their physical violence, whether there was any sexual abuse, different types of violence are being questioned in the court. But how to prove that whether the person has actually underwent more than physical violence? So when we talk about forensic investigation, the investigation is usually done on offenders. And that leads to delayed justice. And we can say that justice delayed is justice denied. So in order to overcome this particular issue, as part of ICSSR research work, a research work is going on to study the victims of domestic violence in terms of their neurosignature profiling. We need to understand what domestic violence is all about. Most of us understand that physical violence is part of domestic violence and especially done by the intimate partner, that is husband or wife, or maybe by in-laws. So the physical violence consists of bodily harm, which may include hitting, pushing, kicked, choked, beaten, pulled, scratched, burned, acid, objects thrown, or there is a murder attempt. So anything done under this type of violence by a family member can be considered as domestic physical violence. But domestic violence is not limited to physical violence alone. It can also consist of sexual violence, like forced to have sex without consent, or maybe raped, forced to say yes, to undergo sexual relationship with somebody else, inappropriately touched, molested, forced to engage in an unwanted sexual act, objects were used during sex, forced to watch porn, forced to engage in pornography, forced to have sex with others, forced to have sex in front of others. So these are considered as sexual violence under domestic violence, and it is done by family member. Anyone from the family, if he or she does that, it can be considered as sexual violence. Then emotional violence, any kind of humiliation, degradation, threatening, manipulation, gaslighted, isolation from family or friends, not allowed to talk, not allowed to share the truth, and forced by a family member not to do all of these things, or giving emotional issues by the family members is considered as emotional violence. And there is also financial violence, like demand of dowry, which is the major cause of filing domestic violence case. Not giving money for fulfilling basic necessities, not giving money for raising and caring of child, not giving money to have food, clothes, to pay the rent, house rent, or in case of working woman, the money is stolen from the purse, almara, or the account of the person. And again, this is done by any one of the family member. It is considered as financial domestic violence. Now, the point is that if it is physical violence, and in somewhat sexual violence cases, there are bruises and there are physical evidences available, as well as medical reports are available. But what about the cases which are majorly dominated by emotional violence, where the case the physical violence happened, but then the bruises and injuries are now filled up, are cured, but emotionally the person is still under trauma, or some related mental health issue is caused because of domestic violence. And because of domestic violence, there has been financial crisis which a person is undergoing just because of marital issues and the type of domestic violence the woman has underwent. Now, domestic violence doesn't mean that only woman is undergoing domestic violence. There are men also who are undergoing domestic violence. So, the emphasis is not only towards a particular gender. It is being studied that how man and a woman is undergoing domestic violence and what type of brain signatures they can produce if they have actually underwent domestic violence. Now, in order to study domestic violence and the neurosignature profiling of such victims, neurosignature system, which is part of brain electrical oscillation signature profiling, was used to study the brain waves and brain activation. So the BIOS tracks the neural processes related to memories and remembrance, which is a step ahead than lie detector and P300 test, not limited to recognition, but it is related to the remembrance of a traumatic memory. As part of neurosignature system, there's no response required from the suspect or the subject. So here we are taking the victims of domestic violence. So we are not expecting any response from the victim. It's a non-invasive technique, so it protects the law and religious principles of an individual. It is also human rights friendly and it avoids physical interrogation. So there is no physical harm or injury caused by the usage of the investigation system. The system looks for the experiential knowledge, which means what the person has actually experienced. And that experiences are stored in the person's memory, which is being recorded and analyzed by the system. The results are automated tested results, and it gives result in less than 1 hour with high accuracy automated reporting. Now, what is happening when a person is listening to probes, which are statements the person has given that he or she has underwent a domestic violence event? So when the ear hears the probes, there is a sound that converts into electrical impulses inside the brain, which get transferred to the auditory region, and it processes the electrical impulses inside the brain, which identify the words, especially the words related to any sort of trauma. It could be physical, emotional, financial, or sexual. And then the words become the sentences. So here, when we do neurosignature system profiling, we are presenting statements or sentences which are related to the phase of event underwent by the victim. And these sentences derive meaning from the entire event, and it triggers the brain neural processing, and this processing triggers memories related to a particular event, and in this case the memory is related to domestic violence event. So as part of the study, we have tried to create a new signature system based profiling of victims of domestic violence and not of offenders or suspects of domestic violence. And also we are trying to provide a shorter, secured and safe environment for investigation of sensitive cases like domestic violence and sexual abuse, etc. And for this, we are targeting 50 individuals each. That means 50 for experimental group who are the victims of domestic violence, and 50 for control group who are the non-victim of domestic violence. But up till now, we are able to complete 20 recordings. So the inclusion criteria was that the subjects will be victim of domestic violence, who are married for at least 1 year. The victims could be male or female. And for control group, married individual, male or female, and who are not the victim of domestic violence. And the age range that we are targeting is 25 to 45 years. Now, for any research work, we have to take ethical clearance. And for this particular research work, when the proposal was presented to IEC, Institutional Ethical Committee of National Forensic Sciences University, the committee gave us ethical clearance. And with that, we started our research work by interacting with government, semi-government, and non-government organizations. And also, we tried to find out individual leads who can help us to get the participants for the research work. Once we started getting the participants, we approached them with a detailed procedure of the research work, and we explained them what is to be done with the participant and how the research work will go, what are the instruments that we are going to use, and what is the process. And after explaining everything, we took the consent from the participants. After taking consent, personal interview was conducted in a safe, close environment, and the confidentiality of the subjects are maintained. We also gave them detailed information about the BIOS system and how it is non-invasive in nature and how the research work can be helpful for the community at large. Participants were also given remuneration to be part of the project as subject, because most of the victims were from low economic status, and for their travel and DA, we gave them remuneration. And if the subject wanted, he or she was allowed to withdraw from the project at any phase of the project. Also, care was taken to provide one-to-one counseling to all the participants, and protection of Article 23 was also taken into consideration. The data collection started with the government, semi-government, and non-government organizations, as well as individual leads. After taking consent, case history was taken, and psychological test was also conducted in order to find out their mental status. And then the recording of data was done. The recording of data was done on the basis of two sets of probes. One set of probe was prepared as standard script, where all the characteristics of domestic violence were part of the script. Total 115 probes were prepared as part of the standard script. Similarly, 115 probes were prepared for individuals' personal experience-based probes, where the individual, as part of experimental group, said that they have underwent domestic violence, and as part of control group, they shared that they have never been under domestic violence. And all these probes were presented auditorily in ABBA design. So when the domestic violence victim underwent BIOS profiling or neurosignature profiling, it was seen that subjects who underwent physical as well as emotional abuse, not only on physical probes, they showed experiential knowledge, but also on probes which are related to emotional abuse or somewhat associated with sexual abuse also showed experiential knowledge responses. Now, the experiential knowledge responses are those responses which says that the person has actually underwent an experience, and which also justifies that the person has underwent domestic violence, and of which type, whether it is of physical abuse, emotional abuse, financial abuse, or of sexual type. So here, particularly of this particular case, She underwent physical as well as emotional abuse. For financial abuse, there was no such EK found. So again, the same case, she underwent emotional as well as physical abuse. Another case, which was part of control group, she said that she has never went under domestic violence and she has a very good relationship with her husband and her in-laws, which was very well depicted in her control group standard script, where she shared her personal experiences and where there was no such violent activity shown in her script. But when the standard script was presented, which was totally based upon the characteristics of domestic violence, she showed a lot of experiential knowledge-based responses on physical, emotional, and financial violence. But that was not related to her husband or her in-laws. It was her past experience based upon her childhood relationship with her family members, especially with her mother. So when we did a follow-up interview and one more recording just to find out whether she has actually underwent domestic violence and she is trying to hide that, she never underwent domestic violence from her husband and from her in-laws part. But something that she was hiding was about her past domestic violence, especially the physical and the emotional and financial violence from her family side. So this is things that we are getting from our research work. Experimental group, those who have actually underwent domestic violence, they are showing domestic violence experiential knowledge on their real life script as well as on their standard script. But control groups who are claiming that they have never underwent domestic violence, as far as marital life is concerned, they have not witnessed domestic violence, but then in some or the other way, they have underwent domestic violence in their childhood. But this was a rare case where she claimed that she has never underwent domestic violence, but as part of the standard script, it shows that she has a strong domestic violence past. So again, you can see that the script is showing a strong domestic violence experiential knowledge-based responses. Most of her responses are showing experiential knowledge that she has underwent domestic violence. And here the last section is of financial violence, where she has also shown experiential knowledge. Now, there were victims who claimed that they have underwent domestic violence. And when both the scripts were presented to them, their real life script and as well as the standard script, they have not shown any experiential knowledge based responses. So when further probing was done and further interview was done, they showed attention seeking behavior, and it was not actually a domestic violence case, but in their mind they are assuming that and they are pretending that they are undergoing domestic violence just to get sympathy from another person. But when we talked with their family members, especially their spouse, they all said that their marital life as well as their family life is very fine. There is no issue. Even the kids of such people shared the same experience, that they have a very smooth family relationship. There is no issue in their family. There is no issue between the mother and father. It's just that the lady is trying to seek attention from other members just to say that her in-laws are harassing her and she is not finding comfortable with her husband and her husband is abusing her. So we also got these type of cases and results, not only from female side, but also from male victims who claim that they are victims of domestic violence. But when we did their script as well as the standard script, none of the script showed any type of violence-based activity. This is how the report looks like. So the probes are presented, and in front of that, you can see the result of each probe. So if probes shows EK-based responses, that means the person has underwent domestic violence. Here, there was a fighting scene which they have shared, but there was no experiential knowledge-based responses. So as far as domestic violence victim cases are concerned, we need to do more in-depth research work to find out what is actually happening with an individual. The person has actually experienced domestic violence, or it's just the created story, and it's just the assumption a person has created inside his brain. Now, in order to answer that, we did a further analysis of each and every responses in terms of brain activation, and we found that those who have underwent domestic violence, their brain activation and the strength of activation was stronger as compared to those who never underwent domestic violence. So when it comes to the type of brain activity a person shows to share the severity of the experience, the severity of trauma, the cognitive neural networking is much more stronger, and there is more gamma activity shown by a person's brain as compared to people who are not facing that type of traumatic event. And if it is just a fake story or just an assumption created by a person's brain. As far as the novelty and innovation, which we as a forensic expert can provide in justice to victims of domestic violence are by using the scientific technology for profiling of victims in closed and secure environment, which is actually not provided to victims at police station or in judiciary. A new approach to help the victim and its family. Up till now, we have discussed many investigation techniques, detection of deception techniques, but all these techniques are used on offenders. What if we start investigating the victim itself with their consent in a closed and secure environment? In that case, we will be able to get more information about the crime and how it has happened. And also, if there is an eyewitness from the family, it can also give early justice. It will help us to understand human brain, how it works, how memory plays an important role in eyewitness testimony, and related neuropsychological aspects. Sometimes a person is suffering with neuropsychological issues like schizophrenia or paranoid behavior, because of which there are different memories created in the brain, which can lead to different types of fake stories created by the persons inside the brain and through his verbal communication. And it can also give a dimension to investigation to cases like Me Too movement. It has actually happened or not. It's just a publicity stunt, or it's a genuine case. For all these things, we can give a new dimension. Cases like child abuse, for that also, we can work with new dimension, confabulated memories, especially when it comes to the divorce cases. And the most important aspect is the protection of Article 23. Offenders are not giving consent because they claim that it is against the Article 23, where they are not supposed to give statement against themselves. Fine, no problem. We can use this technique to do it on victims, where the victim want to help oneself and will bring out the truth in a much better manner as compared to the offender or the suspect. So what I'm trying to suggest here is, whenever it's a case of domestic violence, whether it is physical, sexual, verbal, emotional, or financial, a FIR is lodged and the case is sent to court, where the court tries to determine guilt, and then the protection orders, residence orders, monetary relief, child custody, and compensation related judgments are given. But if we can involve a forensic psychologist after filing an FIR, and if the forensic psychologist, after doing forensic interview in a closed environment with the victim, and then send the victim to the court, and with the court's permission, if all the investigation can be done, which can help through its report to determine the involvement of the victim as well as the involvement of the offender. And then after that, psychological intervention can be provided to the victim, victim's family. And in case, if the case is a fake case where the victim is actually not a victim, but being an offender, the person is trying to file a fake case on in-laws. In that case, psychological intervention can be provided to in-laws and family members, and which will help in giving judgment related to the protection orders, residence orders, monetary relief, child custody, and compensation. So this is what I wanted to suggest from the forensic psychology perspective, that we are only focusing on suspects and offenders. We should also focus on the victims. We should try to find out ways how to help the victim to get justice in less time with better evidences.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for delivering a wonderful talk. Now, I request Soni ma'am to give the concluding remark about this session.
Thank you so much, Ranjit sir. At the onset, I really would like to thank Priyanka ma'am for such a wonderful session. To start with, her point that domestic violence is not limited only to females but also males, definitely something that we need to take into consideration while we are taking up such cases. She has very beautifully reminded us what domestic violence is all about. It's not only about physical violence, which people generally take this up to be, but also sexual, emotional, financial, and how there are certain things that the victims cannot prove. And we have been observing it for a very long time now, that victims become victims again when they are fighting for their own justice, because they have to undergo that trauma again and again, unless and until they are able to establish something like emotional violence, something like financial violence, something like sexual violence. So this is this study, this work that ma'am has been undertaking, which works on the neural processes which are related to the memories of the victim, where the experiences are being analyzed, where a full scientific procedure is being undertaken to establish the credentials of the victims and to understand what is happening. That has been an eye-opener. Personally, for me, it was a great session and something that needs to be brought in the knowledge of a common man, so that we know how victims are not made to undergo the same pain again, and how they can establish that, yes, their pain has been true, the domestic violence has happened to them. Thank you so much, ma'am. It has been an eye-opener session for all of us. Thank you on behalf of all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.